Morning, Cross Point Church. Welcome to the house of the Lord this morning. We're going to invite you to stand. We're going to get right into worship this morning. Amen. How many are excited to worship Jesus? Praise the name of the Lord. He is worthy of our praise. He is worthy of our trust this morning. He is the great healer. Amen. Full of wisdom and knowledge. Let's offer our hearts and our minds to Jesus this morning. Let him do a work in us. Amen. Bless his name.
Call the name Jehovah.
Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, Lord. Trust in Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you for the power of your name.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within his presence. I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there's a hope and there's a freedom. I speak Jesus.
And this is why I speak his name. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadow. Burn like fire. Come on, church, join me this morning. I just want to speak the name of Jesus. Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in over every enemy, and Jesus for my family. Oh, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Come on, do you believe in that name this morning? Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. Oh, oh, his name is power. Your name is power. Yes, your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold and shine through. Open like a fire.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there's peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
Oh, there's power in the name of Jesus. There's power in the blood of Jesus. There's power in the resurrection of Jesus to do mighty great things, to do miraculous things. Let's put our hope and our trust in no other name but the name of Jesus. Shout Jesus from
the mountains and Jesus in the streets. Oh, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy.
Proclaim it this morning.
Jesus for my family. I speak the holy name. Jesus. Oh, and shout Jesus from
erupting Cross Point this morning.
Oh, shout Jesus from the mountains and Jesus in the streets. And Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family. I speak the holy name. Jesus. Oh,
oh, we trust in you, God. We trust what your word says. We trust in your deity this morning, Jesus. For you are the great I am, the Son of God. You are our Messiah, Lord. And we put our full trust in the name of Jehovah. Our full trust and the great healer. We put our trust in the great teacher this morning. And his name is Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Oh God, in our desperation, may we cry out to no other name but the name of Jesus Christ. Oh God, when we struggle with addiction, Lord, may we cry out to Jesus. God, when we don't know where to turn in our darkest hour, Lord, when we are surrounded by darkness and enemies, I speak Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Thank you, God. Oh, we put our trust in you, Lord, this morning. Only Jesus. Simply Jesus. We put our trust in him. Thank you, God. Oh, Jesus. We trust you, my God. We trust you this morning.
Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire time after time.
Yes, he has.
Born of his spirit and washed in his blood. And what he did for me on Calvary is more than enough.
Oh, I trust him.
I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. No, he will never fail. And I trust in God, my Jesus, my Savior, one who will never fail. No, he will never fail. Perfect submission, all is is at rest. I know the author of tomorrow has ordered my steps.
Oh, do you believe that this morning?
This is my story, and this is my song. I'm praising my risen King and Savior all the day long. I trust in Him, and I trust in God, my Savior.
Again, that I can rely on Jesus. Let me tell you about my testimony this morning.
I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. Listen, that's why I trust Him. That's why I trust Him. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. That's why I trust Him. That's why I trust Him. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard.
Us right now where you stand. Oh God, we love you this morning. Oh, we worship you, Lord. We worship you, Jehovah. Oh, Jesus, there is no other name that is spoken with such power. Oh, Jesus, we put our trust in you, God. We rely on you, God. You are our firm foundation and our solid ground. That's why I trust Him. That's why I trust in God. And my Savior, the one who will never fail. Come on, if you know it, sing it. I trust in my church. God, we anchor our trust in Jesus this morning. God, we trust in you. Father, we trust that the word that you're going to bring this morning, Lord, is truth. God, we trust that the word that Trey, our brother, our minister, God's going to bring to us this morning. Father, we trust that he has heard from you, Lord, and we receive that word this morning to make us better people in Jesus. God, we trust in you. Have your way in the rest of the service, in your mighty name. Amen. Amen. Praise his name. You can clap, give him a hand clap of praise. He's worthy. We're going to ask you to remain standing this morning because we're going to move into a time of communion and prayer. In the four corners of the room, we have communion cups. We have two cups, one with juice and one with bread underneath it. When you do move to get the cups, we just ask that you would bring it back to your seat. Just wait just a couple moments so that we can take communion together as a church. Amen. At this time, feel free to get your communion.
Apostle Paul wrote a letter to a group of Christians in the city of Corinth, and this is what he said. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." This morning we proclaim that the death of Jesus on the cross was the death that we deserved. We proclaim that the death on the cross is what wipes our sins away and wipes our guilt and our shame away. And we proclaim that he will come again. Before we partake of the unleavened bread, let's give thanks. God in heaven, we are so humbled and we're so loved. Father, we're so thankful that you loved us enough to build a bridge back to you by placing our sins on the Son and having him take those sins to the cross. It's his name that we pray, and amen. Go ahead and take the loaf. And just the same way Jesus did in this writing from Paul, we're going to pray a prayer over the cup as well. So let's bow again. God in heaven, we're thankful for what this cup represents. We're thankful for the blood that spilled out of Jesus and over our souls. The blood that makes us clean and righteous and presentable before you. It's his name that we thank you, and amen. Go ahead and partake of the cup. Let's all pray together. Father, thank you for this time of communion that we come together as a family and we're remember what was done for us. Father, we pray that as we hear the word preached to us this morning, that will equip us, it will encourage us, and it will make us better servants in your kingdom. God, we pray that you will give us the strength and the humility to be your hands, your feet, your ears, and your mouthpiece in this lost and dying world. This is our prayer in the name of your Son and our Savior, and amen. Before we hear from Trey this morning, just a couple of things for you. As always, if you're here this morning and you came prepared to give a gift, we have a black box in the back of the room. We have, you can give through the website, or you can use a text and text a dollar amount to the number up on the screen. If this is your first time here with us this morning and you want to connect with us, we want to connect with you. Take a card that's in the seat back in front of you, fill it out and drop it in one of the black boxes, and you'll be on an email list and you'll get to hear about everything that goes on here at Crosspoint. One last thing, just a reminder, the last Sunday of this month, we will have another Starting Point session. What's Starting Point? It's perfect for people who are new here, but even if you've been here a long time, it's perfect for you too. Starting Point is a series that we do every once in a while where Trey and the elders will gather, we'll give you a presentation about what we believe, where we're going, and what we're doing as a church, and we're open to any questions. Trey will take the hard ones, and we invite you to take time after the second service on the last Sunday of this month. We will have Starting Point. Now I'd ask you to give you your full attention to Trey and what he has to say to us this morning.
Flown on an airplane before, you have Orville and Wilbur Wright to thank for that, also known as the Wright brothers. Most of us are probably familiar with those names from our history classes. They were the ones who first conquered man-powered flight, and the world has never been the same ever since. But who you might not be as familiar with is a man that lived around the same time. His name was Samuel Pierpont Langley. He lived, like I said, and worked around the same time as Orville and Wilbur Wright. And Simon Sinek, in his research, says that in the 20th century, discovering how to fly a big metal machine was all the rage. Everybody wanted to be the first to figure out how to fly. It was like the dot-com era of the day. And so if you were to take Wilbur and Orville Wright, and if you were to take Samuel Pierpont Langley, and if you were to put them on paper side by side right next to each other, you would assume that Samuel Langley was the one that should have conquered man-powered flight. On paper, he looked much better than Orville and Wilbur Wright. But how come we've never heard of this man, Samuel Pierpont Langley? You know, if you were to introduce a new business or a new company or a new product to the market, most people assume that there are three main ingredients that you need to have the recipe for success. You need lots of money. You need really good minds and really good people backing you up, and there needs to be a market for the product or a market for the business. Well, history tells us that Samuel Langley, he had all three of those. The U.S. War Department, wanting to figure out how to fly, they gave him a $50,000 donation for his research to figure out how to fly. He worked at the Smithsonian, and he held a seat at Harvard University. He was able to pull in the best minds possible to work on this achievement of figuring out how to fly. And the market was certainly ripe. In fact, the New York Times had a reporter follow him around just to record everything he was doing, yet we don't attribute the founding of flight to Samuel Pierpont Langley. It goes to the Wright brothers instead. Why? Well, Simon Sinek, in his research, he makes the claim that it's because the Wright brothers were driven by a cause. They believed that if they could figure out how to fly, that it would totally change the world. It would revolutionize the world for centuries moving forward. Samuel Pierpont Langley, on the other hand, he believed that he was going to get rich and famous. Not much of a cause. And when you look at the Wright brothers, you find out that they had none of the recipes for success. They did not have any money, and they had no donations, no generous benefactors. In fact, they paid for all of their research with the proceeds from their bicycle shop. Everyone that they hired, that they brought onto their team to help get this a product to market, so to speak, none of them had a college education. And they certainly didn't have anyone following them around reporting on everything that they did. But they had a why. They had a cause. And so on December 17th, 1903, the Wright brothers finally took flight. There was nobody there to record it. In fact, we didn't find out until a few days later. And Samuel Pierpont Langley, when he found out that the Wright brothers beat him to flight, he quit. He walked away. Rather than going to the Wright brothers and saying, good job, I'm going to build on what you have done. We're going to make this even better. He just walked away because he had no cause. He had no why to sustain him through the hard times of inventing and trying something new. Simon Sinek concludes, he says, people don't buy what you do, people buy why you do it. And as we continue this series that we're calling Blueprints, Following the Way of Jesus, as we go through the Sermon on the Mount, what I want to try to give you today is the why. I want to give you the why we follow Jesus, the why as to why we would organize our life around this sermon, around this person of Jesus that has forever changed the world. And this why, it all starts with one word, a word that most of us are familiar with. We see it in hashtags on social media. We see it on license plates and bumper stickers. It's a word we still use today, even in our culture, even though Jesus used it 2,000 years ago. That word is blessed. And the whole Sermon on the Mount starts with this word. That's what Jesus uses. Matthew chapter 5, let's pick up in verse 3. He says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the gentle, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who have been persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, and when they persecute you, and when they falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad. Rejoice in your persecution and be glad in your persecution, for your reward in heaven is great, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Now that's a famous passage of scripture, words that you can probably buy on a poster at any home goods store. It's words that grandma likes to knit on her blankets and on her pillows. I mean, these are famous words that most of us, even if we don't have a background in church, we've probably heard them before. We often refer to them as the Beatitudes, kind of a churchy word. It comes from the Latin meaning bless, because these are all pronouncements of blessing from Jesus. And these words, we read them and maybe we're caught off guard by them and we think, man, these are beautiful and powerful and poignant words. But what is it about these words that make them so powerful? Why are they so powerful and why do they speak to us? Well, it's because Jesus flips the script on how we think about life. He totally comes at life from a different angle than most of us look at it. You know what it means when you flip the script on something? It's like that politician that decides to live with some integrity and actually takes his ideas and wishes of the people and represents his constituency well. It's the CEO that takes a paycheck and lives with, or doesn't take a raise and lives with integrity and raises the paycheck of his employees. It's the celebrity who lives with humility, not making everything about him or herself, and actually stays faithful and married to their spouse. We could go through the pages of history, and there are multiple people who have flipped the script. Gutenberg flipped the script on our understanding of information and how information is distributed with the printing press. Galileo flipped the script on our understanding of science and astronomy. Thomas Edison flipped the script and the switch on modern life with his invention of the light bulb. Henry Ford flipped the script when it comes to transportation and his invention of the car. Martin Luther King Jr., he flipped the script on civil rights and how we think about racism. And Steve Jobs, of course, flipped the script on how we think about the world of computing. Jesus comes along with this sermon, and that specifically this part that we call the Beatitudes, and he flips the script. He gives us a revolutionary thought. He goes against the status quo. He does something that none of us are expecting, and he flips the script specifically on how you and I think about the good life, or how you and I think about the blessed life. Now, when I say that term, good life, what comes to mind? For some of you, it may be money. It may be wealth, it may be comfort, it may be stability, it may be a home or being able to get around in a nice car wherever you want to go. It may be having a family or a nice job, it may be performing at the top of your game, or maybe it's just having a little bit of fame. When I say the good life, or when I say hashtag blessed life, every single one of us in this room, we have a different idea, a different image, a different picture that pops into our mind. And so one of the things we need to do before we get into these blessings of Jesus is we need to spend a little bit of time just trying to understand exactly what this word blessed means. We need to look at the word blessed and try to interpret it the way Jesus was speaking it. This past week, Bailey and my kids were over at, I almost said my boys, but there's another one now. Bailey and my kids were over at a friend's house for the eclipse. And when Bailey's out and about with the kids, she'll often send me updates, just letting me know what's going on and where she's going. And so I've got our text conversation from Monday for you and up here on the screen. And just want you to know that I am a concerned husband and father. And so I made sure that if it was the end of the world during the eclipse, that she knew that I loved her. You know, I've been watching too many YouTube conspiracies, you know what I'm saying? And so I let her know I love her. I tell her I'm headed home. And then all I get in response was, heard hope. Heard hope. Hope. I'm like, what in the heck does that mean? And at first I thought, well, maybe somebody just shared the gospel with her, and now she's heard the hope of Jesus, and she's living with a new aspect on life. But I'm like, oh, that doesn't make sense. She's up here leading worship. She already knows about the hope of Jesus. And so I'm sitting there, I'm staring at this heard hope, what does that mean? Literally, it took me like 5 minutes, and then I realized she was headed home. She was headed home. Heard hope meant headed home. But I had to sit there and I had to stare at those words for a few minutes trying to figure out exactly what she means. It was a typo. Jesus isn't making a typo here when he says the word blessed, but we do need to spend just a little bit of time trying to understand exactly what he means when he uses this term blessed. I spent some time this week listening to the Bible Project. They've got online commentary and video commentaries that anybody can access. And they were very helpful in forming my thinking around this word blessed. And what they do is they root this word blessed in the Hebrew language. And they go back to the Old Testament, and there are two terms in Hebrew that can be translated as blessed. The words are Ashrei and Baruch. Not Ashley and Barak, but Ashrei and Baruch. And both of these in the Old Testament in Hebrew, they both mean blessed, but they have slightly different nuances. For example, if you were to sneeze in front of me, and if I was a polite person, I would say, God bless you. That is Baruch. God Baruch you. What that means is I am praying for God's blessing to be on your life. I am asking God to bless you in your life. If you're leaving today and we say, God bless you, we want God to bless you as you go about your week. But Ashrei is a little bit different. Ashrei is used when you see somebody's life and you acknowledge that they are living a blessed life. For example, if you have a smile on your face and you come driving in a brand new car, you got this nice house, I could look at you and I'd say, man, you are blessed. You are Ashrei. But here's the hard thing about Ashrei. Ashrei blessing is totally dependent on the person who is defining what is blessed. It is all about the eye of the beholder. In the second century, there was a Jewish rabbi. He wrote a popular work called The Wisdom of Ben Sirach. And in it, he has his own list of beatitudes, kind of like Jesus, but they differ ever so slightly. For example, he says in his writing, blessed are you when you can rejoice in your children. Oh, that sounds pretty good. You're blessed when you can rejoice in your children. Blessed are you when you actually see the downfall of your enemies. A little different than Jesus there. Blessed are you when you live with a reasonable wife. Just reasonable. Blessed are you when you live with a reasonable wife. Blessed are you if you never have to serve your inferior. Again, veers from Jesus. And so there's some similarities, but there's also some differences. We need to understand when somebody says that is the blessed life, it is dependent on the person who is defining and speaking the word blessed. This last week, I was at the gym on Thursday, and at the end, we're doing a cardio blast after all of our workouts, and Tom demonstrates the exercise, and it's called a donkey kick. And literally, it's what you think. You get down on all fours, and you go up on your hands, and you kick, and you like a donkey all at the same time. And he says, we're going to do this one. This is a good one. And I said, Tom, you and I, we need to talk about your definition of good, because nothing about acting like a donkey in the gym class sounds like a good thing. So this word blessing, to call something good, it is all dependent on the one who is speaking this word good, who is saying this is blessed. See, we often go wrong in our lives when we look at somebody's life and we say, oh, that's the blessed life, because we just assume that everyone else has properly defined exactly what is blessed. When my son Shepherd was born, I sent a picture of him to a friend, and the friend just texted me back, said, you're a blessed man. Says who? Friends, I never had anxiety until I had kids. My bills were manageable before I had kids. Kids just mean poop diapers and pee diapers and loud screaming and long nights and sleepless nights. Says who? You are blessed when you have kids, right? People say you're blessed all the time, and we just take it for granted. We never ask why. And so that's what we want to do today as we look at the Beatitudes. What we define the good life in our culture as comfort and wealth and cars and houses and living with a wife that you kind of like or a husband you kind of like and something that you can tolerate. And we define that as the good life, but we never ask why. Who is it that actually gets to determine what is blessed? We see somebody with money and we say, man, they've got a good life. That's a blessed life. But friends, I know so many wealthy people whose family won't talk to them. And their life is right on the edge of being destroyed. And they're miserable even though they have money. Who gets to define what is blessed? Blessing is in the eye of the beholder. Reminds me of the Chinese proverb. A man has a farm of horses, and one of his horses runs away. And the neighbors come up to him. They say, oh, what bad luck you've had. And he looks at him and he says, maybe. The very next day, the horse comes back bringing with him a wild stallion, a brand new horse that he gets to add to his farm. And the neighbors come to him and they say, oh, what good fortune you have had. And he says, maybe. The very next day, the sun goes out and he's got to break in that wild stallion. He's got to ride the stallion and it bucks him off and he breaks his leg. And the neighbors come to him and they say, oh, what bad luck you've had. He says, maybe. A few months later, the emperor of the nation decides to go to war with another nation, and he calls on all able-bodied men to be served, and in this war, people are killed, and they are injured even worse than they were before, and the son who had a broken leg was spared from going to war, and the neighbors come, and they say, oh, what good fortune you have had, and he says, maybe. And the story goes on and on and on. Friends, sometimes the thing that we think is blessing is actually a curse in disguise, and the thing that we think is a curse is actually a blessing in disguise. As we open up these Beatitudes and these blessings of Jesus, we need to understand that blessing lies in the eye of the beholder. And so when Jesus says, blessed are you because you are poor in spirit, blessed are you because you're gentle, blessed are you because you're a peacemaker, blessed are you when you are grieving, blessed are you when you are persecuted, we should be asking why. Like, it doesn't make sense. It goes against everything that our culture says. Why, Jesus, is that the blessed life? And in his infinite wisdom, he actually tells us why. We ask why, and Jesus tells us why. He anticipates our question. What does he say? He says, blessed are the poor in spirit. And then there's a word that comes right after that, for. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are those who are gentle, for they will inherit the land. And the list goes on and on. Every time Jesus says something is blessed, he answers our why. He gives us an answer to the question. And it's always connected to you will receive something in the kingdom. You will receive something that you didn't have before. So Jesus, he flips the script on what is blessed life. And then he tells us why. When you're poor in spirit, when you're lowly, when you're humble, when you go through those hard times in life, it actually positions your heart and your mind and your spirit to be in a place where you can actually receive the glory and the riches of the kingdom of God. When you mourn and you find yourself in a place of grief, it positions you to be loved on, to be taken care of, and cared for by other people. I know there are people in this room who would say, my greatest grief produced my closest friends. What a blessing that is. You see, Jesus tells us why. Yeah, I'm going to bless you for doing hard things, but I'm also going to tell you why you're blessed in the process. And when you embody these traits, when you embody these attitudes and these ideas in your heart and soul and mind, you set yourself up to receive the blessing of the kingdom. And I hope you can hear the hope in this. Like, I hope you hear the good news in this, because it means that Jesus is redefining and he's assuring that his kingdom is for everyone. This isn't a class thing. This isn't a status thing. This isn't something that's only for the elite. This is a heart and spirit and soul and mind thing. He says that if you can humble yourself, if you can lean into these things that most people don't like, I want you to know that there is a reward that is coming. The kingdom will be for you someday. And he's reminding us and telling us we've been keeping the wrong scorecard. You ever go golfing and you get messed up on which golf hole you're on and you start tracking and it's just not making any sense? Why? Because you're keeping the wrong scorecard. Jesus says it doesn't matter how much money you have. It doesn't matter how much wealth or fame or comfort or stability you have. What matters is that you have more kingdom in your life. And so what Jesus is saying to us is if you're broken up and messed up and beaten up and torn up, this is still for you. You can still come to God. In fact, you are targeted with the grace of God. This levels the playing field. It means people who don't know how to pray, people who are tempted by so many things, people who are anxious and struggle with anxiety at every turn, people who struggle with lust and anger and judgment and hate and cursing and relational dysfunction and discouragement and everything else that the Sermon on the Mount encompasses, this means you can have hope because Jesus says when you are in those states of being, you are now reliant and open and able to accept and receive the blessing of the kingdom. Sometimes our most painful, weakest, lowest moments in life are where we finally recognize our need for him and he pulls us right up to him. Dr. Paul Brand and Philip Yancey wrote a book called The Gift of Pain. And in this book, they tell the story of 4-year-old Tanya. Now, Dr. Brand, who's writing the book, he works for a leprosy clinic in Carville, Louisiana. And this little girl, Tanya, 4 years old, was brought to him by her mother, and he began to give her a checkup, began to look at this little girl, and he realized as she was taking the blood-soaked bandages off of her and looking at her dislocated ankle that she sat there completely bored, oblivious the whole time. And he realized very quickly that this little girl, Tanya, 4 years old, didn't have any feeling of pain, which is a common symptom of leprosy. And the more they dove into learning about who this woman was and what was going on, they realized that she had never been able to feel pain. And when she was 18 months old, her mother first realized it. She was in her playpen. And the mother walked away for just a few moments, and when she came back, the little girl Tanya was finger painting red swirls of paint all over the sheet. And the mother thought, that's strange, I didn't leave any paint with her, we don't even have any paint in the house. And as she goes to investigate where this little girl got the paint, she realized that Tanya had bit the tip of her fingers off and was painting smears of blood all over the sheet. Otherwise, she was a perfectly healthy baby. The problem was, Tanya couldn't feel any pain. And it got to the point, 7 years later, where the mother called the doctor. Both her legs had been amputated. She had ulcers on her leg stumps and on her hands. Her elbows were constantly dislocated. Her tongue was swollen and black and blue and lacerated because she had chewed through it without being able to feel any pain. And things got so bad that the father actually left. He couldn't handle the stress and the anxiety of having a child that couldn't feel pain. He even went as far to call her a monster. Dr. Brand said, she is no monster. She's healthy every other way in life. The problem is she is a real life example, a real life metaphor of what life is like without pain. Not long after that, Dr. Brand was in a hotel room getting undressed. And as he was getting undressed, he realized he had no sensation, no feeling in his foot. And he started to wonder if he had contracted leprosy himself. And so he took a pin and he shoved it into his foot. Nothing. He pressed the pin harder until blood started to flow out from his foot. Still no pain. And he went to bed that night wondering, what is this life going to be like now that I don't have pain? What is life going to be like if I have contracted leprosy? How will I manage a life where I can't even tell if I'm hurting myself? He finally got a few hours of sleep that night. He woke up the next morning just to check again. He jammed that pin back into his foot, and this time he let out a blood-curdling scream and a yell because he felt the pain. It hurt. And he said, from that moment on, anytime I got a cut or I experienced discomfort or I broke a bone, I would always, always thank God for the pain. Friends, sometimes your most broken moment, the thing where you feel weakest, the thing that drags you down, the thing that is constantly giving you pain in your life is the very thing you need to be drawn closer to Jesus. And in fact, doing a life without grief, without mourning, without being gentle, without making peace, without persecution is actually quite dangerous. We need pain in our life so that we can be drawn closer to God. Friends, we got to ask why, and then Jesus tells us why, because the pain will often bring us closer to God, which is where we need to land this plane today. I want you to remember exactly who is talking. Last week, we saw that Jesus, he walks up on the mountain, he opens his mouth and begins to speak. We are seeing the human of all humans begin to talk. We are seeing God in the flesh begin to give a new law for the new covenant for his people. He is laying out the blueprints of what life in the kingdom of God actually looks like. And he says, you are blessed when these things happen to you. And then I want you to notice the four fill in the blank. Every single reason that he gives is all centered around the exact same thing. He says, for theirs is the kingdom, for they will be comforted, for they shall inherit the earth, for they shall be satisfied, for they shall see God, for they shall be called children, for theirs is the kingdom. Friends, do you realize what all of those blessings have in common? Every single one of them are dependent and need a closer experience and intimacy and walk with Jesus. You cannot have a kingdom without King Jesus. There is no comfort without knowing the God of all comfort. There is no inheritance of the land unless Jesus gives it to you in all of eternity. There is no satisfaction in your life and in your heart and in your soul unless you let Jesus in to fill the hole that you have in your heart. You will not see God until you see Jesus, the risen God who died and rose again so that you might live. You are not a child of God unless you are adopted by the blood of Jesus. Every blessing that he gives, every reason that he gives is a deeper, more intimate, close relation and experience with Jesus. In other words, when you live the blessed life, the good life defined by Jesus, the reason is that Jesus is why. You get a greater experience of Jesus. Why do we mourn? Why do we seek to live with mercy? Why are we peacemakers? Why are we poor in spirit? Why is it okay if we are persecuted? Because Jesus is why. Friends, I wish I could just take this stage and add two more words at the end of it so that it would say, Jesus is why. That's why we do everything that we do, every thought that comes into our mind, every dollar we give, every sacrifice we make, every conversation we have, every help that we extend, every sin that we overcome, every change that we make, every cheek that we turn, every grudge that we let go of, every hard thing that we do, every hour we sacrifice is because of Jesus, simply Jesus. Jesus is why. And we should all be asking ourselves, well, why is Jesus so great? Like you're saying Jesus is why, but why is Jesus why? Friends, because Jesus made you his why. Philippians chapter 2 tells us that Jesus did not consider equality with God something to hold on to, but he lowered himself, embodying this beatitude, embodying this humble spirit. He lowered himself to the point where he was obedient to death, even death on a cross, and that death on a cross was for you. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 tells us that for the joy set before him, the joy set before Jesus, he what? He endured the cross. He went through the humility and the shame and the hardship of the cross for the joy set before him, which is you. He wanted a relationship with you. Jesus is our why because Jesus made you his why, and he left heaven and came to earth so that you might live and be with him forever. And friends, I got to tell you, if you have never made Jesus your why, you need to do it. If you know that Jesus has resurrected from the grave, and if you know that Jesus has given you everlasting life, if you believe in him, then you need to publicly declare that Jesus is why, and that everything you do in life is now for him. And we're going to end the service today. I'm going to pray. There's not going to be a song afterwards. If you need to make that decision, if you want to declare that Jesus is why, and you want to talk about baptism, I'll be standing right up here afterwards. Any of the elders with a tan name tag, you can come and talk to, and you can declare in your life, Jesus is why, because he made you his why. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, may we never forget why we do what we do. Every sacrifice we make, every discipline we put in our life, every hard thing we do, it's all because of Jesus. And Father, these beatitudes, these blessings from you, yeah, they seem a little strange to be poor in spirit, to be okay with mourning, to be okay with persecution. God, they seem strange. They do flip the script, but Father, you root it in the fact that we get a greater, more intimate, perfect experience with you. And so, Father, I pray that that would take root in our hearts, that we would live as a people that knows everything we do is because of simply Jesus. And Jesus made us his why, and there are so many people out there who don't yet know that. Father, may they hear the truth of how much you love them, and may we be empowered and encouraged and equipped to live in such a way that points back to Jesus. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Y'all have a great week.
He's a friend of mine.
We got everything we need.
Lift him up, lift him up.
I got that.
Righteous in glory, good for your word, you're loving and patient, you've always been kind, you brought me back to life. I don't know how you always do it, you never change, you're always moving. Never stop you, it doesn't matter. When I feel like I'm worthless, you're calling my bluff. No, I'm not insecure, 'cause your promise is sure, your mercy still endures. And I don't know how you always do it, you never be constant, to be faithful in every season, no matter the season. Not a hand who is able to be constant, to be faithful. Nobody but Jesus, yeah. Not a hand who is able to be constant. be faithful in every season, no matter the season. Yeah, yeah, not a hell. Who is able to be constant, to be faithful? It's only Jesus. Nobody but Jesus. Do you know? It's only Jesus. Nobody but Jesus. Great is your faithfulness. Every day, every day. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Great is your faithfulness. Oh, yeah. I don't know how you always do it. I don't know. You never change. You're always moving. Yes, you are. Great is your faithfulness. Morning by morning. Great is your faithfulness. I know it for myself. Oh, I don't know how you always do it. Yeah, yeah. You never change. You're always moving. Great is your faithfulness. Yes, it is. Great is your faithfulness.
He's a grave robber, he's a wave walker. There ain't nothing that he can't do. He's a storm stopper, he's a death mocker. Now he's given that power to you, so come.
They killed him, but the Spirit filled him. The gates of hell flung open wide. Now that same Spirit, it lives within us. Step into the power of Christ. Dead man, open your eyes. The Lord is with you. Wake up, you see him. Watch what he can do. I hear him calling. Step into the power of Christ. Was found. I should be dead right now, but I am alive. I just wanna see your face. You're calling me from my grave. Take me to the shouting grounds. It's gonna get loud. Shout now.
Jehovah's by my side. Take me to the shouting grounds. A prodigal lost was found. I should be dead right now, but I am alive. I just wanna see your face. You're calling me from my grave. Take me to the shouting grounds. It's gonna get loud.